dealing with a Vatican assassin. Sorry, I'm a high priest Vatican assassin warlock. Panicking is for amateurs and morons. Hope is for sufferers and tools. Again and again, he's going on television saying, everybody who thinks there's a problem with my life is a loser, but I'm not. And I'm tired of pretending I'm not awesome. I've got tiger blood and Adonis DNA. So we're watching this man who's crying out to the world. We're watching this man who's locked in a death spiral of addiction, and he's surrendered to it. He's surrendered to the disease that's killing him, the disease that's already stolen most of his life, his children, his marriages, his work, and maybe his sanity. And the whole time, he's screaming to us at the top of his lungs, to anybody who will listen, I'm well, I'm great, I'm superior, I'm not suffering. You ordinary people might think that, but you don't understand. I'm special. Adonis blood, tiger blood, and DNA. He's like a drowning man who's fighting off his rescuer. And to laugh at that or to scorn him would be profane and hypocritical. Because the honest truth on this first Sunday of Lent is that I see a lot of us in him. I listen to this broken, raging man who's drowning in his own pride, and I see the church, not just us, but the capital C church. I see something of our own manic avoidance, something of our own passionate denial of our own sin and brokenness. Don't we see ourselves the same way? I mean, we're much too discreet and humble to say it out loud, but spiritually, we do kind of feel like we're special, like we've got something that makes us different from the rest of the world, Jesus' blood and Jesus' DNA. So we don't need this season of Lent because we don't have a problem with sin. I mean, we'll pray a prayer of confession every week, but it's in the first person plural. It's all we language. It's not really about me or you. We'll do Lent because it's fine to have a theme for worship for a while, and downing it down a little bit, dialing it down a little bit will make it more exciting and joyful when Easter comes. We'll observe Lent, but we don't really need it. This season of repentance and soul searching and penitence, we don't need it. It's not useful to us. Now, we can use this time to make quiet adjustments in our lives. We can use it as a special season for spiritual growth, a time to become even more holy and awesome in the Lord if we want to, but we don't have to, because through Jesus, we're already good enough. I mean, Lent might be necessary for some people, but not for us, not really. We admit that we're sinners, but it's theoretical. It's like admitting that we're less than God. We haven't done anything really wrong. We're not real sinners. We're not murderers or thieves or cheats or child abusers or promiscuous college students or people who cuss. Real sinners don't go to church. So Satan might be real and powerful in other people's lives, but not in ours. We're different. We're saved by grace. We're sanctified by the blood of Jesus. So we might not be perfect, but we're not sinners. Not really. We're clean, we're immune, we're delivered, we're fine, and we don't need this time, this season. It might be for losers who don't know Jesus, but it's not for us. In our city, there are 4,500 kids that they know of in our public schools who are homeless. Our free and reduced lunch rate is over 50%. According to United Family Services, which is the DSS in our community, every 15 seconds, domestic abuse occurs. And 25% of all those women who are abused are pregnant. Most children will witness abuse, and most children who witness abuse grow up to be abusers. The Charlotte-Mecklenburg Police Department is called out 31,000 times a year, on average, for domestic abuse. Mecklenburg Ministries, the interfaith ministry in our city, did a social capital study a couple years ago and compared it with other cities around our country. They found that Charlotte is the most religious city in the country. More people regularly worship God in this city than anywhere else, and most of us are Christian. But on that same survey, they found out that we have some of the lowest rates of trust between the races in all of the country. So we worship the same Jesus, but we get along less than churches, than cities where there's little faith at all. In our own city, there are young mothers who cook meth in their kitchen while their children play next door. There are so many young men who turn to gangs and violence and drugs because the world tells them that that's their destiny, that that's their futures. There's teenagers in our city who literally take knives to their own flesh because the pain inside them is so strong that they're desperate to get it out any way they can. There's a battle going on in our city between good and evil, and there's pain and hate and violence, and it's winning in so many people's lives. And for the most part, the church, ours and almost everyone else's, we're not doing anything about it. We're shaking our heads, we purse our lips, we might make a monetary donation to someone else, but they're not our kids, they're not our sons or daughters. We don't know those people. People like that don't come to church. And we couldn't do anything for them anyway. We're Christians, not miracle workers. Elie Wiesel, the concentration camp survivor, who's also a Nobel Prize winner for literature, he teaches at Boston University, and I studied with him for 3 years in seminary. And he said, "The opposite of love is not hate, I found, but indifference." The opposite of love is not hate, but indifference. And what he means by that is that very few people in Germany hated the Jews. Really, probably less than 5% of the people were just fanatically opposed and filled with hatred for the Jewish people. The majority of everybody else who were Christians just didn't care if the Jews were systematically exterminated. There's a battle going on every day in our city, and people created in the image of God are being destroyed by evil. They're dying, and they don't know of the hope and new life available to them in Jesus Christ. And for the most part, we just don't get involved because it's not our problem. Jesus came to show us how to be human. And Jesus went to the desert to battle Satan and sin. And so must we. Jesus went into the wilderness to fast and pray and fight because he knew he couldn't begin his earthly ministry or be used by God until he confronted sin and evil. And when he was spiritually, physically weak and very spiritually vulnerable, Satan came to him and told him beautiful lies. Satan came to him and said, "You don't have to be hungry. Turn these stones into bread. If you're really the Son of God, then you can do that. You're special." Satan came to Jesus and told him beautiful lies. He took him to the holy city and sat him at the top of the highest pinnacle of the temple and said, "If you really are who you say you are, if you